Now, I've been thinking about that because I remember when the Magic thing went down, I was on a plane going to interview the Ghetto Boys in Houston. We had just arrived in Houston, and everybody in the airport was like, man, I was like, it was like a real memorable day when Magic made that announcement.
Yeah, no, I remember, man. It was like the first person to come forward and basically not die. You know what I mean? Basically, people come forward like Eazy-E, and then boom, 2 weeks later, he's dead.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's a definite, you know, game changer.
Yeah.
With how HIV is viewed, you know, because I mean, I grew up being terrified of getting AIDS.
Yeah, like, I mean, come on. It was made
the 80s? Come on.
Yeah.
It was a death sentence. You got AIDS, you died. That's basically how it worked.
And what made it heavy for us being an artist is so many people around were dying first, like creatives, you know.
Yeah, man. I mean, I'm glad that it's somewhat under control now. I mean, not completely under control, but somewhat.
Yeah, it's much more it's much more under control than it had been. And then also recent studies with stem cell science that two people possibly have been cured.
Yeah, I mean, you can get a bone marrow transplant and you could potentially get all the HIV out of your body. You just might die in the process of getting that transplant. That's a very serious operation. It's not a shot or a pill. It's like they literally, you could die in that on that operating table. So,
right.
Yeah, man, like I said, with Eazy-E, which I've discussed, you know, on the show with some of his friends and so forth, that sent shockwaves through hip hop. Like, here's one of our heroes who just died of AIDS. Like, wow.
Yeah.
Like, it was just one of those things.
Yeah, most likely a heterosexual transmission. And then coming back on the graffiti tip, not as celebrated, but a very dear friend of ours, a graph artist named Dondi, who passed of an HIV-related illness, and a beloved person, you know, just really just sad that too many people left us with like that at that very tragic time. It's really devastating.
Well, you worked on what a lot of people consider to be the first hip hop movie, Wild Style. It is the first hip hop movie. Okay.
It's definitely the first, baby.
Okay. I didn't want to step on someone's toes.
You
may have done some indie joint.
Like, no, stepping on no toes, but we were the first. That flag,
you were the first.
Planet.
And for those that don't know, if you listen to Nas's Illmatic, which is considered one of the greatest hip hop albums of all time, the intro of that album is the Wild Style theme song.
Well, he uses a Wild Style theme. He also uses a scene from the movie where the graffiti, the star of the movie, one of the stars, Lee Quinones, is having a discussion with his older brother who's just come home from the army on leave. And Lee's done this beautiful painting in the room. And his brother says, you know, has a big argument with him about, you're doing this nonsense? What, man? You know, and then Lee confronts his brother like, this is my art. This is my thing. And that is the scene that Nas uses the actual audio in the beginning of his album, Illmatic, which was deeply moving for me. And I think later when I became cool with Nas, I also directed one of the first videos from that album for the song One Love. And I remember vibing with Nas and he said, yo, my pops took me to see that movie when I was 9 or 10 years old. And it just was like amazing that, you know, the effect it had on him. And then to make that Illmatic album a certified classic on a par with Miles Davis' Kind of Blue. And, you know, it's just pretty amazing.
Yeah, man. And then, you know, from there, you get to Yo MTV Raps, which was the first national hip hop show ever in America.
Yeah.
And which is how I got introduced to Fab Five Freddy, where you basically gave the first interviews to damn near every hip hop legend.
Yeah, at that time it was amazing. There was a guy by the name of Peter Daugherty and Ted Demme, two guys that worked at MTV were very big into rap, aware of this movement growing, developing, record selling, going gold, platinum with no marketing, no video, no nothing, just on the word of mouth, on the strength of the force of the culture. And they campaigned and lobbied MTV to like do something. And these guys, especially Peter Daugherty, they knew that I had made all these connections downtown, was tight with people in the band Blondie. I mean, I'm featured in their video. They shouted me out on that record, Rapture. They said, listen, man, he's the guy. And I was shocked when they called me because it was in 1988 and I had just directed the first music video I did, which was My Philosophy, for an artist by the name of KRS-One. And I made this video as strong and as black as the lyrics and the content of the record demanded, never thinking. People were like, yo, do you think this is gonna be on MTV? I'm like, B, I'm sure this will never be on MTV because I'm putting this thing down in the proper format. And next thing you know, I got this call to host the show. You know, they did a little screen test. They loved it. And on the very first show, I played My Philosophy. And I was like, this is really felt like change is about to come. A change is going to come. And a change came. And the show had the highest ratings in MTV history right out the box. My idea was never to be cooped up in a studio like them previous MTV VJs because they began to look real corny to me. So I was like, man, look, I want to do my show on the street, in the basement, in the studio, like wherever the artists are, I want to be right there in that energy, in that moment, you feel me? And that's, they said, look, let's do it. No MTV shows was shot like that at the time. I mean, you can go on YouTube and see little moments here and there, but that was a game changer in terms of, for the channel MTV, in terms of remote shoots, on the move, in the groove, whether I'm on 125th Street with Big Daddy Kane or in Bed-Stuy with Kane, or I'm in Compton with NWA the first time you see them, or going to the Fifth Ward in Houston with the Ghetto Boys, like I was saying before. So that was a great thrill and an interesting moment for my natural sense of curiosity, is to be in these different places where this culture is now taking root and find out what's going on in the Fifth Ward, what's going on in South Central, you know, in these different places, what's going on in Liberty City, like with like Luke and those guys at that time. It was really fascinating to share that with the rest of the country and around the world.